Hello, everyone. Welcome to Inner Renewal Week. So nice to see so many of you joining us from distant places and also on the internet. We want to give a little introduction first to what Inner Renewal Week is. This is not for beginners. We started this as a way for the members of the residents of Ananda Village to have a week-long group seclusion, one might say, if you can have a seclusion with 200 people. But the purpose of it was to go deeper in our teachings, in our practices, and in attunement with our guru. And so the classes that we'll be offering this week are not meant for beginners. They're based on an understanding that you've read, the commentaries on the books that we'll be discussing, that you're familiar with the Gita, the Bible, Master's approach to the commentary. So it gives us a chance that we can, instead of holding back so that everyone understands, if you don't understand, just run along with the pack, because that's what we're trying to focus on. Our theme this week, as you're probably aware, is the search for God as presented in the world scriptures. And so before we begin our focus today, let's just look at some broader aspects. What are scriptures? Let's start with that. Scripture, from the Latin root scribere, to write. So essentially what it is, it's revealed wisdom that has been brought down to the conscious mind and translated into the written word. A divine experience can never be fully translated into the written word, although I must say Master's poem Samadhi bridges those two worlds of divine inspiration and the written world. But most scriptures, including the ones we'll be talking about this week, the Gita, the Bible, Patanjali, and the autobiography of a yogi, there is a certain component in them where the true meaning is veiled. It's hidden because it can't be expressed in ways that the rational mind would understand. And so Christ spoke in parables. The whole Bhagavad Gita and Mahabharata is rich with symbolism, because through these parables, allegory, symbolism, those great visionaries, the great men and women of God, were able to express higher consciousness in a way that that people will get on different levels depending on their own level of consciousness. And so Christ said, "I speak in parables because seeing they see not, and hearing they hear not." And so what we will be trying to share in these classes is to pull aside the veil and to be able to really go deep into the true meaning of these scriptures. In Swami's wonderful book that is sometimes overlooked, The Promise of Immortality, he has a wonderful sentence that just, I want you all to think about it and go deep with it. He said, "A great scripture is such to the extent that it addresses the grand issues with authority." To address the grand issues with authority. And what are those issues? What is reality? How was it created? What is our part in it? But the thread that runs through all the scriptures, true scriptures, is how we can channel our energy so that we can achieve oneness with God. And so ultimately the scriptures, though allegorical, not directly explained, are very practical. They're not just something to say, oh, that's wonderful, I didn't understand any of it, it must be very deep. They're to show us how to find God, each in a different way, each emphasizing a slightly different aspect of the search for God and how to achieve it. Now, how do we study the scriptures? In autobiography, in the chapter Years of My Master's Hermitage, Master talks about studying at Sri Yukteswar's feet in the ashram, and how they would, Sri Yukteswar, they would open up. He was talking about when they were studying Patanjali, which we'll address on Wednesday. But they would read one little sutra, one little sentence, and then they would meditate for an hour. And then the guru would say, "Have you understood?" And some of the disciples, perhaps already getting restless and thinking about the lunch break, said, "Oh yes, Master, we've understood, we've understood." And Sri Yukteswar said, "No, I don't think so. Go deeper." They'd meditate for another hour. And so it was until finally he felt that they were aligned with the true meaning of what Patanjali was saying. And this went on for many, many, many months. And they'd only studied two or three sentences in that period. But after a time, Sri Yukteswar looked at Master and he said, "You have understood now, not only Patanjali, but you have understood how to draw the true meaning from a scripture. From now on, everything will be, any spiritual literature that you turn to will be revealed to you." And so in our own study of the scriptures, we need, if we want to, any book, autobiography, any of the books we're talking about, or any book that is rich with spiritual meaning, before you pick it up casually and say, "Oh, let me see what this says today," if you really want to understand it, meditate first. Calm your mind. Ask to be inwardly attuned to the true meaning of it. Just as Sri Yukteswar was training Master, we too can do this. Because we won't always have outward guides. We ourselves have to use these great books as our personal guides to moksha, to freedom. And so we need to approach them in this way. So what ones will we be focusing on this week? As we've mentioned, today we'll start with the Gita, then the Bible, then Patanjali on Wednesday, and then Friday, autobiography. And why particularly these books? Once a visitor said to our guru, to Master, he said, "Why do you give particular emphasis to the Bible and the Gita when you call yourself a church of all religions?" And Master, wonderful response, he said, "It was the will of Babaji that I do so." He said that our line of gurus came to show the underlying similarity between the original yoga of Krishna and the original Christianity as presented in the Bible. And Master said, "Babaji told me to show the underlying unity of these great works, and that is why I was sent to the West." And so it's not a little aspect of what our line of gurus are. You know, I can tell it's going to get warm in here. We should open some windows, please. And maybe even the back door if it's not too noisy. So this is why we are focusing on these. But it's interesting because God comes at different times. He speaks to humanity at different times in different ways according to the needs of the development of that period of human consciousness. And if when we look at the cycle of the yugas, it's very interesting where these four scriptures fall into place, because they take us from the very end of descending Dwapara Yuga, the cusp between Dwapara and Kali, then through descending Kali Yuga, and then finally back up into ascending Dwapara. The Gita, I mean, these figures, the dates are more or less accurate. The Gita came to humanity about 800 BC. So that's just at the cusp between descending Dwapara and the beginning of Kali. And then we go down, and about, Master said, that Patanjali encoded the teachings. Why is Patanjali related? It'll be revealed on Wednesday when we talk. But it's the condensation, the practical aspects of the Gita that Krishna talks about the process, Patanjali talks about the vehicle, the ways that we achieve the consciousness that's delivered in the Gita. So about 300 BC, we have Patanjali. And then we skip down to so that's about 400 years into Kali Yuga. Then we skip down to the Bible coming to us after the birth of Christ, 60 to 70 AD. And so that's right in the heart of the depths of Kali Yuga. And then there's a period of time. We come to Autobiography of a Yogi. 1946, we could say 250 Dwapara. 1946 AD, obviously, 250 Dwapara. And now we're moving out of the Dark Age. We're moving up into where, although sometimes it's hard to think we're not in the Dark Age, you know, but technically we're not. And Swamiji said when he was writing, working on the Gita commentaries, that Master said, the true explanation of the Bhagavad Gita could not be delivered in Kali Yuga because man's minds were too trapped in form. It was only when the beginning of a glimmer of the awareness that form is not the absolute reality, but energy, that the true meaning of the Gita could be revealed. So we have the delivery of the Gita, the codification of the techniques of yoga by Patanjali, the expression of Christ in the middle of the Dark Ages to try to awaken in the midst of matter consciousness, a higher consciousness, and then finally moving up so that we begin to have an understanding. I never realized that it was actually Lahiri Mahashaya who showed that the Gita, not the Gita, the Mahabharata from which the Gita came, was actually an allegory of the soul's descent and then ascent from matter consciousness to God consciousness. So that was Lahiri who first began touching on this. And all, so you see, all of our line of gurus are part of this process. Jesus Christ, Babaji Krishna, Lahiri, Sri Ekteshwar, training the guru, and our guru master, who was Arjuna in another life. So it's when we talk about the true meaning, we have to realize it is of the scriptures. It is at the core of the mission of our masters. And it's not, when someone said to me yesterday, oh, you're going to talk about the scriptures, that's going to be kind of intellectual. And I didn't know what to say because I knew what we were going to be talking about. And I, you should come. It's not going to be just intellectual. So that's all by way of a preamble. And now, because the Gita is a dialogue between Krishna and his disciple Arjuna, who, as we know, again, was master in that lifetime, we thought to try something different this morning. And we are going to do a dialogue between Arjuna and Draupadi, to get the name pronounced properly. And go back with us in time to about 800 BC. But now we are at a point in time, 2 years after the battle of Kurukshetra, after the Gita has been delivered. And there is a family gathering, and as we know, the Pandavas in the end were triumphant, but at a great cost, a great loss of life of almost the entire Kshatriya race was destroyed at that time. And so 2 years after the end of the battle after the Gita was delivered to humanity, the Pandavas are gathered for a family dinner. And they're sitting in the large banquet room. And then Arjuna remembers, it was only 2 years ago that the war ended, and before that, that Krishna spoke to me and gave me the Bhagavad Gita, gave the world the Bhagavad Gita. So Arjuna's remembering this, and he enters a very thoughtful state, and he leaves the banquet room, and he finds his way out into the battlefield. And he stands on the very spot where Krishna had taken his chariot and where he asked the question, why do we have to fight? So this is where we begin our dialogue.
This is the spot, the very spot at which Krishna spoke to me before the great battle. I'm remembering the dialogue, I'm remembering the battle, I'm remembering all of my friends, some of whom played a little role of enemy at that time. But as I remember, let me invite Krishna also to join us.
My Lord, why have you left the family gathering? Everyone was asking after you. And what are you doing here in this empty battlefield?
I was pensive. I couldn't stay in the room with the people because this is only 2 years since the dialogue with Krishna. And of course, that was the eve of that terrible, terrible battle. And so I'm remembering that dialogue and remembering the many, many conversations with Krishna that took place before and after, with him explaining the meaning of life, explaining why we're here, explaining the whole of the universe, revealing the universe to me.
Yes, Arjuna, I too remember that terrible war and the suffering that went before it that led to that day. But why did we have to fight that war?
Well, it was destiny, of course. You know, the world is created out of duality. And one way that that duality expresses itself is through light and dark, through good and evil. And when evil or darkness or selfishness becomes so powerful that it begins to drive out the light, then the hearts and minds of people everywhere begin to call out to God, please, can't you help us? Can't you help somehow help us overcome this evil? And God hears that. God is the very prayer that they're offering. And so he manifests himself in the form of an avatar. And so in this case, Krishna came. Because of the pleas of mankind, he came to drive out evil and reestablish goodness.
But there was such a tremendous loss of life. Yes, Krishna came, but the battle still happened, and our sons were killed. And why was there such a tremendous loss of life, and why did our family have to be destroyed, who are living in accordance with right action?
Well, God ever needs vehicles to accomplish his purpose. God is both sides, after all. And so it was our destiny to be born at this time in order to take on this great battle. And not only was it our destiny, after all, look at our family. Our mother were great souls. We were born from the great side of the family that represents light. And each of us is partly the child of our mother, but also the child of various gods. And so we were born into this world to accomplish this purpose. And you yourself came full-blown out of a sacrificial fire in order to accomplish this very purpose. And so one could say that it was obviously our destiny to be born at this time. But there's also a deeper reason and a deeper purpose. You know, this battle, even though it took place over 18 days, is a battle that will be remembered for thousands and thousands of years. Because it's not a battle really between our family and the Kauravas, even though that's the way it played out. It's a battle of good against evil. And this dialogue with Krishna was explaining how we become, how we evolve into the goodness from which we were born. But this battle, as I say, was not fought just for us, for this time, for this period, but it was fought in order to show people everywhere, far, far into the future, how they too can battle against the evil that is within them. Because ultimately, our family, the Pandavas, and our enemies, the Kauravas, are all one nation, all one consciousness. And the Kauravas are within us. They represent those qualities of darkness or evil or that which pulls our consciousness down. They represent that. And unless we battle against that, how do we overcome it? So it isn't outward, it's inward. We have to carry on that battle. But it's really for our sake that this war took place. And symbolically, on a deeper level, it's good against evil, but expressed as tendencies and qualities within each of us.
In thinking of our cousins, the Kauravas, some of them were better, some of them were worse, but they each seemed to represent a specific aspect of our consciousness. Do you have insight into that?
Well, Krishna told me, he addressed this. He said, let's go back just a generation. So our father, Pandu, represents pure discrimination. And our parents, Madri and Kunti, represent dispassion and the desire for non-attachment and renunciation. And so we're born from the line of discrimination plus dispassion, which allows the consciousness to withdraw from this world, this battlefield, this field of Kurukshetra that is with us all the time. But on the other side is Dhritarashtra, who was born blind. He represents the blindness or the blind mind within each of us. And he is married to Gandhari. And Gandhari, because her husband was born blind, she, once upon learning that she was betrothed to a king who was blind, chose to blind herself, to wear a veil which she never took off for her whole life. Now that sounds noble. It sounds like what a beautiful sacrifice that is. But if we look at a little deeper level, why should someone choose to blind themselves? What is the meaning of that? And she's attachment to desire. And so desire blinds us, but we choose to be blinded by, it's not as if we're born blind the way Dhritarashtra was. We choose to be blinded through our desire. And from their union are born all of the Kauravas, 100 sons. And they represent all of the qualities born of blindness and desire. And so the eldest son represents king material desire, Duryodhana. And the second son represents anger. And so on, all of the negative qualities. And so each son, even their name, implies a particular quality that draws them down. We, on the other hand, represent those qualities that lift the consciousness up. So again, it's a battle of good and evil, but good and evil in our own consciousness. And so we must fight that. Our family represents the 5 chakras of the inner world, of the inner spine. And so we have Sahadev, who also represents the beautiful power to avoid evil, or Yama. And then we have his twin brother, Nakula, who represents Niyama, the power to do good or to automatically accept that which is good. And I represent the 3rd chakra, fiery self-control. And Bhima, big, powerful, blustery Bhima, he's the heart chakra, the power that comes from the wind god, his father, the power of vitality and expansiveness. And then Yudhishthira, born of the god Dharma, he represents the power of calmness, power of pure discrimination, and the power to be uplifted, and finally to be so uplifted that we withdraw our consciousness from the senses, and therefore can worship Krishna perfectly.
And where does Krishna fit in?
Oh, Krishna, Krishna. Now, what a man. He wasn't a man, of course. He was God's. See, we're all born of different qualities, as I've been saying. But Krishna, even the gunas are different qualities. But Krishna is beyond the gunas. So he's God in pure form. But he comes into this world in order to play his part in the drama. And so he's both in this world and beyond this world. All of the rest of us, we're still hypnotized, we're still dreaming, we're still caught in this plane, thinking that what we see and what we do is real. But Krishna, Krishna is so far beyond. He's never caught. He causes things to happen. During that time, 2 years ago when I was with him, remember, he opened his mouth and I saw universes in there. I saw him make and unmake whole galaxies. He's beyond. He can create or manifest or destroy anything that he wants. So he represents God in pure form, without any taint of, one could say, hypnotism of this lower world, represents God in that pure form who comes to us, but playing the part of a man, playing the part of a warrior, playing the part, in this case, of a lowly charioteer, playing that part so that we don't hold him in such awe that we can't relate to him. Remember, as I was saying, when I looked and saw all those galaxies, I was frightened. Here was my cousin that I knew and grew up with and laughed with and played with, and all of a sudden I see that he's not my cousin. He's the whole universe and beyond. I was frightened by that. And I said, oh, thank you, Krishna, but please, can you come back and just be my cousin again? It was too much for me, too much for all of us. So he plays the part, God playing the part of a mere mortal.
But as you were describing, my Lord Arjuna, if you are representing a chakra in each of the Pandava brothers who, through a quirk of fate, I happen to be married to all of them, then Krishna must reside here. And then where is Draupadi?
Draupadi, wow. Now that's the most interesting of all. See, the quirk of fate is no quirk of fate at all. You represent the animating force that animates all of those chakras. You represent Kundalini itself. And why did you have to marry all of us? Not because I came home and said to my mother, look what I've won, and she said, share it with your brothers. Of course, we have to keep our mother's word, but that wasn't the real reason. The deeper reason is that if we're each of the chakras, you're the animating power of Kundalini that flows and uplifts all of those chakras and finally unites us with Krishna.
But Arjuna, if Krishna was everything you say and who I know him also to be, why couldn't he just prevent this terrible war and the terrible loss of life?
Well, that is what I thought too. That's what I asked myself. Why should we fight? Why do we have to fight? It doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem fair. But strange as this may sound, Krishna allowed this war to happen out of compassion and out of love. Now, it seems a terrible thing, but come back again to the realization that we are an accumulation of qualities, all of us. We're the Kauravas and the Pandavas. We're all of it together. And God has given us the free will to choose which of those kingdoms, our kingdom or the Kauravas' kingdom, that we want to live in. Who do we want our ruler to be? Do we want it to be Krishna? Do we want it to be Yudhishthira? Or do we want it to be King Material Desire, Duryodhana? So we have that power to choose. Now Krishna, knowing that we have free will, and knowing that our evolution spiritually depends upon us making the higher choice and eschewing the lower choice, he allows that free will to be at play. Yes, he could have come and he could have stopped the war, but how then would we have grown? How then would we have chosen? How would the Kauravas have learned that evil is wrong and leads to destruction? How would we have put our energy and our life force, our very blood and our children behind the desire to lift our consciousness and lift the world? God could take away that free will. He could vanish this earth. But why? Why would he want to do that? It's his play. Everything is his play. And everything in life is meant to give us a choice between good and evil.
As we stand here on this barren field, I wonder if anything will ever grow here after all the blood that was spilt on this soil. My heart remembers that day as I wandered through the fallen heroes looking for the bodies of children and loved ones. And yet Krishna told you there is no death. How can that be?
Well, there are several explanations, but two are the most important. First of all, even though we are deluded into thinking that we are this body, we're this mind, we're this personality. We aren't that. We incarnate. And last life, you and I had a different body and a different personality. And next life, we will have a different body and a different personality and a different reason for being. And so incarnation after incarnation, we come and we go. And so this body is nothing more than clothing that we put on. So to kill the body is not to kill that which animates the body, the soul. We are the soul that incarnates over and over again. And so this terrible war and all the warriors that were slain, all the carnage that was done, those warriors are now just on the astral plane, and we'll join them as soon as we leave this body behind. And so in that sense, there is no death. There is no death of the soul that animates the body. It goes on and on and on. But in another sense, and this is what Krishna explained to me, when I refused to fight and I slumped in the chariot and I said, because I was still in confusion, I was still thinking that this body was real, this body was our essence. I said, how can I fight against my cousins? How can I fight against Drona, who was my guru in warfare, against Bhishma, who's the grandfather of us all, against Vidura, the wise and compassionate? How can I fight against them? I can't do that. I'd rather die than do that. And I slumped, ready to give up the battle. And Krishna, first of all, you know what he did? He smiled to show his love and his compassion. And then he explained, not only does the soul never die, that all of us will live again, but more importantly, for spiritual evolution, because we have to remember that that's what this is. It's all about spiritual evolution. That these qualities, all of the Kauravas, Duryodhana, and all of his 99 brothers, they represent energy that has been committed to a certain quality. In their cases, negative qualities, anger and lust and desire and jealousy and hatred and revenge, all of those negative qualities that we can choose or not choose, but energy that's been committed to that. And when we slay them, we don't slay the energy, we only slay the quality that it has been committed to. And then the energy is free from those tendencies to be redirected toward upward lifting tendencies. All a fight of light and dark. And our choices allow us that gradual evolution toward the light. And then Krishna said, you know, Arjuna, the difference between us? I remember all our past lives, and you remember them not. Because of that veil that is put over your mind, you think that this life is the only one. You think this is the reality, but it isn't. I remember. I remember all of them from the past. And even more, I remember the future.
My husband, you seem to have assimilated so deeply the teachings of Lord Krishna. And you imply that there is a purpose behind repeated incarnation, that our consciousness evolves and developed. Can you explain this to me?
During the dialogue with Krishna, he touched on this in several different ways so that I could understand it more deeply. Remember, I said that God was able to create this world because of duality. So let's begin with that. So we have duality. Just as you take a vina and its string and you pluck that string begins to vibrate. Now, that vibration goes between two poles. Let's call one of them plus and one of them minus. One of them light, one of them dark. But until you pluck that string, there is no outward reality. And so the potential with duality is there to create the sound. But until it is animated, you don't have that sound. And so we can call the plus and the minus and the animation, we can give them different names. So let's call the plus sattva. And that's one of the gunas, the upward lifting, the freeing, the expansive, that which takes us ultimately into the ether and beyond material reality. And let's call the darkening tamas. And so that tamasic vibration, remember they're just poles, they're just vibrations. That tamasic vibration draws the consciousness downward to the earth element, thinking that we're solid, we're real. In fact, we're separate from everyone else. And the way to get ahead is not only to celebrate our separateness, but who cares what we do to others? That's why Duryodhana and his clan could not rule this kingdom, because they were committed to the downward flow toward tamasic energy, and that tamasic energy would ultimately cloud the minds of everyone and create not a heaven but a hell. Our side is committed to the sattvic energy. But in between animating those is rajas. And rajas, the animating quality, creates restlessness and desire and movement. And so we have the two poles and we have the rajasic element, the animating force, and those form the three gunas. So all of us, you, me, our ancestors, the Kauravas, Duryodhana, all of us are combinations of those three qualities, those three gunas. And according to that combination, ultimately we want to become like Krishna. First he had to become completely sattvic. And when he became completely sattvic, that plucked string ceased to vibrate anymore. And he went beyond the three gunas. But you and me and everything in this world is a mixture, admixture of those three. And so what we're trying to do is have our consciousness more expansive, more sattvic, more uplifted, more toward the light, and renounce the darkness. But the Kauravas celebrated their darkness, and they wanted to not only make themselves darker, but make the whole world a reflection of them. And that's why this war had to be fought. It's really a choice between good and evil, but good and evil as it resides within us. So we have those two poles, and ultimately everything that we do gradually allows us to evolve more and more toward the positive pole until we become completely positive. And as Krishna told me, there are actual techniques and ways of living and attitudes that we can choose to practice and choose to adopt that will bring us more toward the light until eventually we lose the hypnotism that keeps us separate and know that we are that light.
So, Arjuna, my Lord, you seem to be implying that there are different stages, not only in the Kauravas who represented one pole, but stages of human evolution represented throughout humanity.
Yes, and Krishna, again, he explains so much. You know, we think of the castes as just the Shudras and the Vaishyas and we, the Kshatriyas and the Brahmins. We think of that is just kind of stages or, I don't know, conditions that we're born into. But it's not that. It represents this growth from darkness to light. And so the Shudra represents someone who is almost at the far pole of darkness. And so, you know, you're that lazy fellow who does your gardening for you. If you don't constantly push him or threaten him, you find him asleep in the shed with a bottle of wine beside him. Because all he wants is to go to sleep. He's barely more than the earth that he works with, his consciousness, of course. His soul is just the equal of us. But here I'm talking about his consciousness is barely past the earth that he works with. And he constantly wants to dull his mind and lay down on that earth as if to merge with it. And then where he gets his wine, he goes to the shop, and there's the merchant there, Romesh. And Romesh is perfectly willing to sell him as much wine as he wants. But why? Because Romesh, he's not going to go to sleep. He wants money. And he wants the power and the people adulation that comes when he has money. And so he doesn't care how he earns it as long as it comes to him. And so Romesh, he'll sell you a broom, he'll sell you a veena, he'll sell you a bangle, and he'll sell you a bottle of wine. He doesn't care because he's thinking only of himself. And so that's a higher level than the lazy gardener, but it's selfish and driven by desire and by materialism. And when he worships, he will worship the lower gods and he'll pray to them to give him more wealth, to give him more power, to give him status in society, but it's all about him. And then there's we, the Kshatriyas, and we have come to understand that what will help fulfill our happiness is to serve others, to help others. That's why we were, in order to wrest the kingdom away from the evil, dark rule of Duryodhana, we were willing to sacrifice ourselves. Not for ourselves. We didn't want to die. We didn't want our sons to die, our brothers and cousins and others to die. But we were willing, if it took death, to do that in order to free the population that was being ruled in darkness by Duryodhana. And then finally, so we, the Kshatriyas, have evolved, but not all the way, because, you know why? Because we still think that we do it. The Brahman, the true Brahman, realizes there's nothing, no play whatsoever except God, and that no one does anything. Krishna does it all. God does it all. But that's a high state, hard to achieve. And the Brahmins who wear the thread, most of them don't realize that. Only a very few. But that is the goal, to understand that we don't do anything. We don't fight. We don't live. We don't die. It's all a play of God. And only God is doing this play. But he allows us to dream in the delusion that it's we who are doing it. But you and I, we want to wake from this dream.
My Lord is, oh, what do I see? Look what I found, my Lord, the very conch that you blew on the battlefield.
Yes.
And
thrilled
the armies of the Pandavas. Can you blow it one more time so that that great resonance echoes throughout the world? But my Lord, now that the conscious are silent, the drums are no longer heard, the armor of the warriors is laid down, and many souls have ascended from this earth. Do you still feel now that it was right to fight this battle?
Of course, my human heart still wonders whether it was. The pain, the human pain that we all suffered, not physically, but the losses that we incurred, the losses that we caused. The human heart still is in pain. But Krishna began his dialogue with me by saying that we have no choice. We have to act. We have to fight. If we don't fight, there will be no evolution of consciousness. So everyone on this earth has to act. If nothing else, the mere taking of a breath is a kind of action. The eating of food, the drinking of a glass of water, all of these are actions. So we are compelled to act, whether with our will or against our will. So the question, when I was ready to slump and not to act, Krishna explained I had no choice, I had to act. But I needed to act within the righteousness of my own purpose. And you and I and the Pandavas were all born with the Dharma, with the very reason we came into existence was to act, to bring about good and overcome the power of evil. So I have to act. Everyone must, and everyone according to their own level. That lazy gardener has to act, and the merchant, Romesh, he too. Each of us acts according to the level of our consciousness and the lessons that we need to learn in this life, and that's our Dharma. And so right action must take. We must act. Our choice is whether to act rightly or not rightly.
But how can each person find what is their Dharma? What is the action that will take them, that will help them not only to fulfill their worldly responsibilities, but to free them from worldly responsibilities, all responsibilities?
Well, you know, this is subtle, and it's difficult to know, because the very mind that we have is clouded with delusion. And according to the level of our consciousness from past lives, the poor Shudra is born into a world that is so foggy and so confused that how can he know whether he's going to act rightly or not? He can't. And so the best thing for him is to allow him to associate with those who are less confused, who are wiser. And so that's why to employ a person like that is doing good for him. Romesh, the merchant, according to his understanding, being selfish, trying to get rich, selling things that he knows are not good for people, nonetheless, according to his understanding, that is right action, because it is fulfilling his desire for wealth and for prestige. And for us, the Kshatriyas, each of us has a range of options, one might say. But within that range of options, as each incident in life, as each choice comes, somehow intuitively we know with that there is a higher option and a lower option. And so our job is to try to, with our free will, always choose the higher option. And so the merchant chooses that option which will allow him to get rich. We choose that option which will allow us to do our duty because that's where we achieve our higher step. But the true Brahman, the true action, the best action, is that which is done for no selfish purpose whatsoever, for no reason other than that we are required to act and this is the right action to do. That is what Krishna called nishkam karma, action without any desire for the fruits of that action.
From what you are saying, it seems that right action, or dharma, is not just something that exists on the level of human activity, but that it is a universal principle by which everything is governed.
Everything. God himself is the prime actor. And so the very creation of this world was done out of nishkam karma, out of right action. Ultimately, that's the vibration that permeates everything. But we, in our confusion and in our egoic desires and the patterns that we have achieved or not achieved in past lives, those tendencies, we opt for one thing or another. And it's only gradually, slowly, slowly, that the consciousness evolves out of that miasma, that fog. In fact, this is frightening, but Krishna told me it takes millions of incarnations for the consciousness to finally evolve until it wants no longer to have any form whatsoever, to become pure light and to merge with the light, and then ultimately not even the light, to go beyond, because God exists beyond creation, not only within creation, but within creation. The constant attempt to choose the right path, the higher path, is that which moves us in an upward direction. And the tendency to choose the wrong thing, the evil, the dark, is what moves us away from the light. And because those two forces are balanced so close to each other, it takes a long, long time. And we're just so blessed to have someone like Krishna who is looking after us and helping us and guiding us and giving us the clarity of thought so we know how to choose and how to act.
My Lord, I have asked you many questions, and perhaps you are a bit thirsty. I will ask you one last question. Is what you are describing, is this what they speak of as Sanatana Dharma?
All of this is Sanatana Dharma. You know the essence of Sanatana Dharma, which is, one could say, the eternal righteousness. The essence of it is that we all came from God as a projection of his consciousness. And as he projected that consciousness outward, it took on the appearance of separation. And we, as souls, as sparks of his consciousness, wanted also in that manifested universe to take on the delusion or the appearance of separation. But ultimately we came from God, and implanted in each of us is the desire to return to that state. So the essence of Sanatana Dharma is that everything proceeds from God, and everything eventually will come back into unity with God. And that applies to each one of us. We are sparks of God's consciousness. And right action, desire, the gunas, the castes, all of it together gradually works as one whole, so that we gradually, having gone out, come back to God. Just as when you throw a ball in the air, it seems to rise, but then it reaches a point at which it stops its movement, and then it begins to come back, and eventually comes back into the hands of the one who threw it. It is God who threw this universe up, and it's for each of us at different times. We yearn to return to those hands that put us into movement. Now, you've been asking me questions. Let me ask you a question or two. What did you feel? You were a part of this. In fact, in some ways, your incarnation was specifically incarnated in order to be a part of this, in order to act as the instrument by which the evil was driven out. What did you feel during this battle? What do you feel now?
Dear Arjuna, I was not a warrior on the battlefield. I took up no spears or swords. I rode in no chariot. But I had my own experience of how to deal with what that battle that we were all a part of. Years ago, Krishna asked me, Draupadi, do you practice yoga, concentration? And I said, no, my Lord, I would like to, but my mind is always fixed on you, so I can't practice the techniques of yoga. And he smiled. And so for me, and my battle was perhaps in some ways more terrifying than yours. I remember watching our elder brother Yudhishthira gamble away our kingdom, gamble away our lives, gamble away everything we owned. And the insolent Kauravas, I remember that day, infamous in history, where they dragged me out into the courtroom and tried to tear off my sari. And yet the more they pulled, the more that piece of silk extended and extended by the Lord's grace. And rather than being shamed in that moment, I was blessed beyond anything I had experienced. I too had my moments where in those years of exile, when we lived on the ground, eating what we could forage, dressed in bark and rags, leaving my life of privilege in the palace. But always we knew that the Lord was with us. Just as when you, at the beginning of the war, when Duryodhana came to Krishna to ask for his help. And in your humility, you knelt at his feet, while in his arrogance, Duryodhana stood at the head of his bed as the Lord slept at that time. And so when Krishna opened his eyes, it was you he saw first. And he said, how can I help you? And you asked him at that time, not for his armies or his chariots, but only him. And Duryodhana, the king material desire, celebrated in your foolishness to choose Krishna over the armies. But it was through that choice that we won. And so, yes, my Lord, I fought my own battles, but ultimately the only battle, the end of all battles comes in surrender. And in those moments of darkness and loss and despair that come into everyone's life, if we can remember his words, cling to me, adore me, place no one else before me, and you shall speedily come to me. And that was the battle I fought, the battle of unwavering faith and devotion and trust in the Lord. And so this is the battle that all of us must fight in times of darkness, cling to the Lord, adore Him, bring offerings to Him. And this ultimately is the final battle. Which wins? The forces of darkness within us are the aspiration and devotion for the Lord. And ultimately, that was the message that I received from the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna's son, where he said, my devotee is never lost. And so hope, strength of character, faith, devotion, trust in the Lord, these were my weapons, and that is how I fought the battle of Kurukshetra.
But Krishna now is gone from this earth. He's on another plane. How, without him in the body, how do we carry on?
Oh, my dear Arjuna, he is never far from our sight. He resides forever at the Kutastha Chaitanya. All we have to do is lift up our gaze to that point. And he is there in all his glory, with his beautiful smile, with his robes of gold, with his eyes, his lotus eyes, filled with wisdom and compassion and grace. It is up to us to remember and lift up our souls in union to him.